First topic, so last class we were discussing till demonetization. We'll discuss about this shale gas, okay? So why it was in news? Recently, cabinet gave nod for exploration of unconventional gases. Earlier, government came with help. Now they are saying yes for exploration gases like shales. While discussing hydrocarbon exploration licensing policy, I already briefed about the process of extraction of shale gas. Okay, I have some pictures for better clarity. We will revisit that topic briefly once again. Okay. So, based on our geological surveys and based on our previous exploration informations, we came to know that we are having good amount of shale deposits in various basins of India. Generally, when you compare the natural gas and shale gas, those are also gases only. But what makes it different? It is trapped between shale rocks. The shale rocks are sedimentary rocks, right? These gas, example for shale rock, okay? Shale sleets, these are called as shale sleets. Or the gas are trapped in between the shale rocks, which are very deep inside the earth. Natural gases will be found in less than 1,000 meters. But if you want to take the shale gas out, you have to drill around 2,500 meters. And the recovery rate will also be very low when compared to the regular conventional natural gases. All right. So these shale basins, first we will see. What happened? Right. So these are the shale gas basins present in India. Cambay Basin, this Gujarati areas. Gondwana Basin, somewhere here. I hope you know what is Gondwana. Gondwana land, Pangaea 1, Pangaea 2, right? Krishna Godavari Basin, Kaveri Basin, Indo-Gangetic Basin, Assam Basin. If you look at it, most of the basins are present in delta regions, in river delta regions. Can you say why? What deposits? So basically, if you look at the civilization process, you will find population settlement near deltas, where you will find large amount of organic substance also. Okay, over a period of time, those organic substance converted into fossil fuels. So it is an action based on the temperature, pressure, and time. It will change its forms. From solid, it will change to liquid. Then it will turn to gas. Right? It is a process. So central government, as I said, they recently approved. Now we will look at the pictorial, you know, explanation of this hydrocarbon exploration, especially with respect to shale gas, right? Which we call it, that method we call it as fracking or hydraulic fracturing. So what I do? So it is a thickly densed, either it is populated or you have thick vegetation that has to be cleared, set up a well, and there will be a drilling process, right? So just drill, go deep, go to 2000 plus meters, and one particular point you have to change the direction from vertical drilling, you have to go for horizontal drilling. This technology was not available for a very long time, right? That is why fracking is new to us. So then we have to go for horizontal drilling. So what we will do, after constructing the well, these are wells, after drilling the wells, I'll be pumping in large amount of water at a very high pressure with some sand and also with some chemicals, right? At a very high pressure, I will be sending around 8 million liters of water. On an average, per well require 5 to 9 million liters of water, right? In the Neduvasal region, in the Pudukkottai region, they have planned for hundreds of wells. Right, so one well demands 8 million liters of water on an average. At a very high pressure with the sand as well as its chemicals, it will be sent inside. So this amount, if you want to know the magnitude of this amount, this will be sufficient to meet the water requirements per day for 65,000 households. Right, so what happens? All the sand particles at a very high pressure along with water that creates some sort of explosion. The chemicals are actually explosives which acts as a catalyst for further explosion. After exploding the shale rocks, it gets slightly disturbed. In those disturbances, the sand will be making sure that the rock is not coming back to its original position. Right, so some sort of gap will be maintained. So what happens when there is sufficient gap? The gases can easily escape. Like how we open a Pepsi bottle, how gas comes up, automatically the gas will be coming out, and thus gas can be taken by those. Well, I can suck out that liquid from which I can take the gas also. The problem is during this process, some amount of gas will be leaked, and these are greenhouse gases. Right, this might cause global warming. That is one problem. Right, so it can escape, there is a possibility. And also, after using that well, don't think I'll be using that well for one time. I'll be using that well for multiple times. So multiple times, I inject 8 million liters of water with along with some chemicals and sand, and I have to reuse the well. So I will remove the water, and again I will fill it. Again I will try to extract as much as possible to understand. Let us say I'm drilling inside. I'm going for horizontal drilling. So let us say only up to this area I have went. Now after injecting water at a very high pressure, I am able to extract shale gas present in these areas. Next time what I will do, I will have to remove the water. I have to refill the water. Further, I'll go for some more drilling. And I will try to extract the shale presence in at a extra distance. Right? This process will continue. So don't think one well is used for one time. After completing the process, then that well will be sealed. That well will be sealed with some chemical. Are you getting my point? That well has to be sealed with chemical. The problem here is, in the previous instances, we came to know that there are some leaking incidents. These chemicals are getting leaked. And one more problem is, these shale gas are present naturally closer to natural aquifers. That means it is closer to the groundwater table. So these leaking can go and contaminate the groundwater. Already we saw about arsenic contamination, how that affected the groundwater and how that resulted in contamination of paddy. That was recently in news. Same thing can happen, right? So I am not going for one well, I go for multiple wells. Right, and another problem with respect to this fracking method is, see, like how I open Pepsi, gas alone will not come, Pepsi also will come out. Yes or no? So there will be some flowback water. That flowback water with large amount of contaminants, that is going to be leaked in the surface. Right, so one well will leak large amount of water. That area, surface area, will lose its soil fertility. Hundreds of well, this is going to continue several times. Then just imagine what kind of damage it can cause to the agri field, because these are delta areas. Clear? So yes, so as I said, these leaking can go and it can affect the natural aquifers, and that is called as methane poisoning. Right? So I have explained in terms of words, whatever I have explained, the entire process I have explained in terms of words. So as I said, the recovery rate is very low when compared to the conventional gas. ஓகே ரெக்கவரி லேட்னா ஒன்றும் இல்லை. ஐ இன் கன்வென்ஷனல் கேஸ் ஐ கோ வித் த இமேஜினேஷன் தட் ஐ கேன் எக்ஸ்ட்ராக்ட் தீஸ் மெனி யூனிட்ஸ் ஆஃப் கேஸ் ரைட் அப் டு 90% ஆர் 80% சக்ஸஸ் இஸ் சீன். பட் இன் ஷேல் ஐ எம் நாட் ஏபிள் டு ரெக்கவர் வாட் எவர் ஐ ஹாவ் இமேஜின்ட். இட் பிகம்ஸ் ஆக்சுவலி டிஃபிகல்ட். ஸோ தெர் ஆர் லார்ஜ் அமௌண்ட் ஆஃப் என்விரான்மெண்டல் கன்சர்ன்ஸ். டைரக்டர் ஜென்ரல் ஆஃப் ஹைட்ரோ கார்பன்ஸ் தே ஹவ் செட் அபவுட் சம் யூனோ கன்சர்ன்ஸ் விச் தே ஆர் ட்ரைங் டு அட்ரஸ். ஸோ அஸ் ஐ செட் திஸ் ப்ராசஸ் நீட்ஸ் அரவுண்ட் 5 to 9 மில்லி லிட்டர்ஸ் ஆஃப் வாட்டர் பெர் வெல் ஒன் டைம். ஸோ வேர் வி ஆர் கோயிங் டு சோர்ஸ் தோஸ் அமௌண்ட் ஆஃப் வாட்டர்? இன் டெல்டா ரீஜன் வி வில் பி டிபெண்டிங் ஒன்லி ஆன் ரிவர்ஸ் ஆர் கிரவுண்ட் வாட்டர். டெஃபினெட்லி வி கே நாட் பிரிங் சீ வாட்டர். இஃப் அட் ஆல் வி பிரிங் சீ வாட்டர், இமேஜின் லார்ஜ் அமௌண்ட் ஆஃப் சால்ட் வாட்டர் வி ஆர் கோயிங் டு ட்ரை டு சென்ட் இன்சைட் அண்ட் வி டு நாட் நோ வாட் கைண்ட் ஆஃப் டிஸ்டர்பன்ஸ் இட் கேன் காஸ் ரைட். ஸோ டைரக்டர் ஜென்ரல் ஆஃப் ஹைட்ரோ கார்பன் இஸ் லிமிட்டிங் தி யூஸ் ஆஃப் வாட்டர். ஹி இஸ் சேயிங் தட் மேக்ஸிமம் இன் கன்வென்ஷனல் மெத்தட் ஆல்சோ ஐ எம் சென்டிங் சம் அமௌண்ட் ஆஃப் வாட்டர். வென் கம்பேர்ட் டு கன்வென்ஷனல் மெத்தட் யூ கேன் யூஸ் 5 to 10 times ஆஃப் வாட்டர் நாட் மோர் தென் தட். கிளியர்? அண்ட் ஹீ சேஸ் தட் மேஜர் என்விரான்மெண்டல் கன்சர்ன்ஸ் வில் பி டேக்கன் இன் டு அக்கௌண்ட் த்ரூ சம்திங் கால்ட் அஸ் என்விரான்மெண்டல் இம்பேக்ட் அசஸ்மெண்ட் இஐஏ. இட்ஸ் அ ப்ராசஸ். சி இஃப் ஐ வாண்ட் டு டூ மைனிங் ஆக்டிவிட்டி, ஐ வாண்ட் டு கன்ஸ்ட்ரக்ட் அ டேம், எனி திங் விச் இஸ் கோயிங் டு அஃபெக்ட் தி என்விரான்மெண்ட், இன் தட் கேஸ் அ சோஷியல் இம்பேக்ட் அசஸ்மெண்ட் ஹேஸ் டு பி மேட். How this project is going to impact the environment, society, positively, negatively, etc. That report will be submitted to Forest Department, Environmental Minister Department, whatever. Right, several departments it will be submitted, then government will be giving approval. So he is saying that, anyhow EIA is going to conduct this assessment, only when the damage is low, only in those areas, we are going to give license. The problem with EIA is, as of now, the assessment process for conventional extraction and unconventional extraction are one and the same. Are you getting my point? I go to doctor. They conduct my investigation. Assuming I'm having a bacterial fever, they conduct some investigation. But I'm having viral fever. That will not be helpful. Are you getting my point? So the assessment method for conventional extraction is something different. For shale, it should be different, but they are using similar method, right? That is one problem which was highlighted in this article, right? So this assessment actually generally will be made by an independent regulator. An independent person will come from outside, an environmentalist or ecologist, and he will be submitting his report. A recent study by Duke University, who studied this hydrocarbon exploration process from 2011 to 2016, it stated that the water use per well in USA has increased by 770% times. That means what? First time I use some amount of water. Next time I use extra amount of water. Next time I use more amount of water. That has been increased by 770%. Right? So some shale wells, it demands around 42 million liters of water. We saw on an average 5 to 9 million liters of water is demanded by a well. But there are certain wells, it might require 42 million liters of water. So over a period of time, the usage of water will dramatically increase. See, in this case, how the people in the US are not largely opposing this kind of exploration. Tamil Nadu, Patna, we are, you know, opposing it. But if you take countries like USA, they are not opposing much. They are also opposing, but they are not opposing much. Why? No, not like that. The natural resource in India is owned by government. The natural resource in America is owned by public. The oil beneath my land is mine. Are you getting my point? So there will be a profit sharing agreement between the farmers as well as the explorers. So the profit is being directly shared with the farmer who is giving the land. In case of India, the profit is shared between government and the private explorer. So that monetary incentive is actually motivating. Clear? But still there are large amount of instances where they are opposing. So if you want to give some sort of solution, suggestion to resolve these kind of problems, to address the apprehensions of the farmers, you can write this point. But keep having said that, monetary compensation cannot be the solution for everything. Right? Because your land fertility will be gone. Other concerns, as I said, yes.
Why should you always use fresh water?
Use pannunga. Pudukottaki eppadi kondu povinga sea water? I want to take the sea water to Pudukottai. So I have to go for constructing pipes. The input cost will further increase. Definitely you can go for salt water. I do not know whether it is feasible or not. The input cost will increase drastically. Adukna I can import the oil and go. Whether it is worth doing. We are not coming forward to connect our rivers through canals. But for oil exploration, you know, we are expecting the government to, who knows, they may, if it is so profitable. Angiyum pandrangappa. Tamil Nadu namakku theriyudhu. Right? But the problem recently in Nedumbassal is, very recently cabinet gave approval for shale gas exploration. Are you getting my point? Previously, in the NELP regime, after help is the problem. In NELP regime, I get permission for one extracting one kind of hydrocarbon. There are certain conditions I should not violate. I go and I can extract only that kind of hydrocarbon. If I get for shale exploration, only after that I can do for shale exploration. Are you getting my point? Shale exploration is dangerous. Many knew that. Okay, so if shale exploration licensing is given, people will directly oppose. But inge enna prachana? Inge they fear because of help. They are getting license for extracting some kind of natural gas which may not cause sufficient damage. But what help says? You get license for extracting any kind of hydrocarbon. Uniform licensing. Get one license, we can extract anything. Any kind of hydrocarbon can be extracted. So people fear. You say that you are going to extract natural gas which is present at 500 meters. But who knows? You may even drill more, you may go for fracking method. Possibility irukkum illaya, that's a chance, right? That is the fear. Right? Other concerns is methane poisoning. As I said, the contaminants might get leaked. So what is the guarantee that the well is, so strong? Some cracks in the well can result in leaking of these contaminants. Right? That can go, that can mix with the natural aquifer. Then water will start burning. Like how we burn kerosene, we can even burn water. Many videos are there on YouTube. You would have noticed that. Right? So what is the need of the hour? Comprehensively regulate the fracking process for a sustainable shale gas exploration is what the author is saying. The author who wrote the editorial, he is saying this could be the need of the hour. But the need of the hour, we'll always put our burden, like how we put on God. In answer, in paper, mains paper, don't put the burden on God. Put the burden on science. Both are same. Right? Put the burden on science. That all the hope should lie on science. Right? We have come up with various, take solar. We want energy. For which we want oil or gas or whatever. Solar alone can give self-sufficiency. It has so much of potential. So work on solar. Netherlands, a very small country. They are pioneer in electric vehicles now. Right? From need for oil, go for other form of hybrid vehicles. Reduce the pressure. Every year we are importing 8 lakh crores worth of oil. That creates so much of stress. In that case, domestic exploration is required. We saw in that particular discussion. But at the same time, this domestic exploration should not cause a large amount of impact to the environment as well as society. The point here is, what we need? The growth or development? Right? It is mandatory we should have growth for development. But what kind of growth we want?
Sustainable.
Of course. Sustainable growth. Growth, money venunga. From what source we want money? The source should be moral, ethical, genuine, legitimate. Yes or no? So here, you know, by damaging large amount of fertile fields, right? Already agriculture itself is going against nature. Yes or no? Agriculture itself is going against nature. For your selfish reason, you are domesticating some wild plants, right? And you are consuming in large. The way it is wrong. We are not having a life, we are not going along with the nature. Right? So continuously we should not take things which are going against nature. Fine. Let us move on to next topic. Foreign aid and pride. So UAE came forward 700 crores for Kerala disaster relief. Right? So Indian government, they refused to accept. But again, there was no formal announcement. But there was an informal formal announcement to the state chief minister, right, which was leaked by the government of Kerala in Twitter. That's okay, but for that informal announcement, formally our central government replied that definitely we won't accept. So what is the reason? They are saying that there are some policy directions which was created by the previous UPA government when during 2004 tsunami, the government said that we will not, India is not a poor country, we are not going to accept any foreign aid. But let us see what Dr. Manmohan Singh said. So he was saying that we feel during 2004 tsunami, we feel that we can cope up, right, with the situation on our own, and we will take their help if needed. That means he is not keeping a full stop. He says, if required, definitely we will take some help. And he is not giving any policy directive. He is not giving any legal directive. It is a political statement, that's all. Which has not much legal significance, right? So 2004, decision was not to accept foreign participation in relief, but in long-term rehabilitation, by case, we can decide. That was the stand of the then UPA government. Apart from that, since 2004, in various policy documents, government of India have expressed that they can very well accept foreign aid. Even in the current government period, 2016, in National Disaster Management Plan, it is clearly mentioned that if the government of another country voluntarily offers assistance, the central government may accept it. They are not saying that we won't accept. They are saying we may accept it. Okay. At the same time, they are not saying we will accept. Right? So, what are the reasons? What all could be the reasons for the, you know, refusal of this aid? One is national pride. So, India is not a poor country. So, any longer we don't need any help or anyone's charity. If that is the case, in 2005, America was having a very big hurricane. In 2008, China was facing a huge earthquake for which India sent aid, financial aid. Does it mean that China and USA are poor countries? No. The sense of national pride getting affected because of receiving aid cannot be accepted. Self-sufficiency. Okay. So, self-sufficiency is correct. So, of course, we are self-sufficient in normal times, but during time of disaster, when there is large amount of damage to your wealth, in that case, are we really self-sufficient? If we are so self-sufficient, when Kerala asked funds, immediately government, central government should have given extraordinary funds. But they were able to give only 50% of what Kerala demanded. So self-sufficiency cannot be accepted. What are the strings attached? So whenever a foreign institution, an international financial institution, when they come forward to extend loan, that always come along with some sort of conditions. Okay, so I will slightly deviate, but it is part of your syllabus only. Okay, we will take what happened in 1991. We were having BOP crisis. Yes or no? Balance of payment crisis. That means what? What is BOP crisis? My export is less than my imports. Let us say I export $500 worth of goods. I import $1,000 worth of goods. In that case, I have a deficit of $500. So this has to be returned back. From India, these $500 should go to America. But RBI is not having sufficient dollars. There is a
dollar scarcity. So while giving the balance, there is a balance of payment crisis. So in this case, when countries are facing balance of payment crisis, there is an institution called as IMF, International Monetary Fund. So this will come forward and this will extend help for the countries which are facing balance of payment crisis. What is the role of World Bank? They will be giving loan for infrastructural projects, big projects with a very low interest rate. Okay, but IMF will focus on helping countries which are facing balance of payment crisis. Clear? So how this IMF works, we'll briefly see. Briefly, I'll explain. So to become a member of, or members of IMF, they will be contributing to IMF. They will be contributing money to IMF. India, China, USA, whoever wants to be a member, they join. They will contribute to the IMF. Based on their contribution, this IMF will be giving you some virtual points. Let us say you go and purchase 1,000 rupees worth of goods from any supermarket. They are giving you some points, right? That points is proportionate to how much you purchase. I purchase for 1,000 rupees, they give me 100 rupees, 100 points. I purchase 2,000 rupees, they give me 200 points. Similarly, based on my contribution, they give me some virtual units that I call it as SDR. Special drawing rights. Based on the contribution, some special drawing rights will be provided. Right? So these special drawing rights are also called as virtual currency. This is an example for virtual currency. Some points will be given. Let us say I go to Nilgiris, I purchase for 2,000 rupees, they are giving me 200 points. The 200 points is worth 2,000 rupees. One particular day, I have no money. But with that 200 points, I can make some transaction. I can purchase some goods. Similarly, when I have balance of payment crisis, this virtual currency, this SDR, can be exchanged for your imports. Are you getting my point? The SDR acts as a virtual currency. Let us assume that even that SDR is not sufficient for doing my repayment, SDR is not sufficient. In that case, this IMF will come forward to help India or countries that are facing BOP crisis. Remember, IMF will not directly lend. IMF will ask its member countries to lend. In prelims, if you come across a statement that IMF will directly lend, that is wrong. IMF, it will ask the member countries to lend. It will ask the member countries to lend to the country which are facing BOP crisis. For this help, now this is a financial assistance during an emergency situation. For this assistance, IMF was giving us several conditions, several demands. They were putting some several demands. One is opening up of economy. I have to go for liberalization, right? And another important was devaluation. Devalue your currency. What will happen if you devalue your currency? My exports will increase. If my exports increases, automatically I will be getting large amount of forex. Of course, imports will become costlier, but they are saying restricted imports. First, you want forex. So you have to go for devaluation. India also went some 20 plus percentage value of a currency was devalued by that time. I'm not aware of exact number. They went for devaluation and large amount of forex was coming inside because of boosting in export. Are you clear? And also it asked us to reduce our export duties so that there will be a boost for exports. Are you clear? So these are some strings attached to this financial assistance given by the IMF. So 1991 new economic reforms was not a choice. It was a compulsion created by our poor import cover. In 2016, for the first time, we achieved an import cover which can cover the imports for 10 months. Right? Since 1991, that was the first instance where we were having a import cover which is sufficient to cover or sufficient to pay balance of payments for 10 months. But 1991 situation, we were having import cover with which I can pay balance of payment only for 21 days. Right, that is why 2016, there is a question on import cover. 16 prelims, import cover came in news, import cover came in question paper also. Are you getting my point? So we fear, puriyudhingla, how IMF works. So we fear that these assistants will also come up with some sort of issues, conditions, demands. So we are refusing. But we have to differentiate the assistance given by the institutes like World Bank or IMF and also UAE. UAE is not coming forward to help India when Chennai was facing floods. UAE was not coming forward when other parts of the country was facing disasters, let's say Uttarakhand or whatever. Right? For Kerala, it is coming forward because large amount, diaspora, large amount of Keralites, they have contributed to the growth of UAE. So they have some moral obligation for the reconstruction of Kerala. That is why they are extending. So both these points cannot be compared. They also celebrate Onam. All right. So fear of foreign aid. Another point is generally we fear foreign aid. In the name of something, foreign money is coming inside. Right? And we use that money for some other purposes. Let us say, for example, some religious minority institutions, they are bringing large amount of money inside and they are trying to use it for several other reasons, maybe for destabilize the political economy or destabilize the politics, political stability, or destabilize the political, our economy, maybe for internal security threats, for creating some security threats that money can be diverted. So there are large amount of fear why a particular institution is getting so much of funds. So government came with something called as FCRA, Foreign Contribution Regulation Act. So through that act, it curtailed a large amount of foreign contributions. Having said that, recently government has amended the FCRA, right? For what reason? Political parties, now they are allowed to accept funds from foreign institutions. They have amended the FCRA. If they are so worried about the foreign contributions, why they went for amending the FCRA? That is another question. Money won't bring relief. Of course, yes, money alone cannot bring relief. We need a proper governance structure. We need proper workforce. We need a proper plan to utilize that money. Right? Which better state government than Kerala can do this? Kerala has topped number one public affairs index. In governance aspect, it is bottom, yeah, public affairs index. Governance aspect, Kerala is the number one. Right? So in that case, this money can be effectively utilized. So this point cannot also be negated. Dent at federal character. See, UAE is not giving money for India. It is giving for Kerala. Right? In that case, India or central government should have considered the opinion of Kerala government before rejecting it, but unilaterally dent for rejection. So that, you know, results in a dent in the federal character. Right? So these were the, so what was the final opinion of the author? So seeking or receiving or looking for aid is not the question. It's about accepting. Right? When countries like US, China, Japan, during humanitarian emergency situations, when they accept, why not India? We can also accept. Not at all the cases. On case by case, we can decide. Just like that, we need not refuse. That was the author's opinion. Next topic, compensation to patients. Johnson & Johnson, one of its subsidiary called as DPI International, they are manufacturing prosthetic implants. Those prosthetic implants are used for hip joint operations, hip joint surgery. So whenever hip joint is damaged, right, for proper activation of the hip area, we need to have a sort of ball kind of bone which helps in movement of the hip area. If that gets damaged, we can go for some prosthetic implants. This DPI International is working on manufacturing these prosthetic implants. Right, it got approval to bring those kind of implants in India in 2006 from Central Drugs and Control Organization, CDSCO. So this CDSCO will be giving approval for new drugs, for new implants, for new scanning devices or any medical devices, right? So they got approval in 2006. And these implants are largely made up of cobalt, chromium and molybdenum. Right, in 2007, somewhere in the world, there was an indication that something has gone wrong because of these kind of implants. First official signal came from Australia, Orthopedic Association National Joint Replacement Registry. They were showing that there's an extraordinary high number of implant recipients going repeated surgeries. I went for a hip joint surgery and large number of patients are coming for resurgery. And there are many instances where there are large amount of side effects faced by the patients after this surgery. And they also found that there is a leak of this cobalt or chromium. The particular prosthetic implant is made up of some substance. Those substances are getting leaked and that is causing side effects. So in 2009, Australia, they announced recalling of all those products. In 2006, we gave approval, right? Just follow the timeline. So Johnson & Johnson, it did not inform. From 2007, it came to know there are some issues. In 2009, it was made official by Australian government. It did not announce anything about the issue to the Indian regulators. In 2010, because of so many instances, it voluntarily recalled these implants which were sold in different parts of the country. In 2010, it went for corrective surgeries. Whatever sold, it went for recall for whomever they were. It was used as hip joints replacement. For them, they went for corrective surgery. They were funding for corrective surgery. Right? So, first Indian surgery happened in 2014. In 2007, there was a case. Right? In 2014, first surgery is happening in India. So, they are saying why there is so much of delay in coming up with some surgery for Indians. They are saying we are having a problem in tracking the people who have went for these kind of joint implant surgery. So Australia, see, we saw Australia Orthopedic Association National Joint Replacement Registry. That means that is a registry which gets the track record of all the patients who have underwent some sort of orthopedic surgeon. Right? They are using some sort of prosthetics. Who are all the patients? Who are all of use these kind of prosthetics? They have a track record. But India, there is no such registry. So Johnson & Johnson is saying we are finding it difficult to track the patients. Out of 4,700 implants done in India before 2017, only 1,032 patients were identified so far. In America, Johnson & Johnson is paying up to 3 crore rupees worth of compensation for all the patients who went for these kind of implants. But in India, so far, no such compensation announced. Right? So in 2017, so many people, they were raising their concerns regarding this issue. In 2017, after 10 years of the first instance, Indian government, it appointed a commission headed by a doctor to study about this issue. And he went, he studied, and he submitted the report. He said that, yes, there are larger instances where the people were going for recorrective surgery and many are facing side effects. So he is saying minimum 20 lakh rupees of compensation should be given to Indian patients. Along with that, other financial losses which they faced has to be compounded, for which he says a committee, let us appoint a committee, let that committee, you know, finalize what should be the amount to be compensated. And this doctor commission is also saying that we have to come up with an independent registry, like how Australia is having. We have to come up with an independent registry to track the usage of high-risk medical devices. And he's also suggesting that every, let us say, medical devices, right? They must have, whenever we approve, we must have a medical devices rules. Whenever you approve, that medical device should hold the accountability. If anything happens in future, because of the use of that particular device only, in that case, they must held accountable. In the medical devices rules, it should be clearly mentioned. Even in the devices also, it should be clearly mentioned that if something happens, this will be the compensation level. So here, holding Johnson & Johnson accountable is becoming a difficult task. Right? So government's move, why it came in news recently, health minister, he appointed a committee. In 2017, the doctor recommended setting up of committee. Now he has appointed a committee in 2018 to determine the compensation to patients, right, by collecting the information from patients, from other commissions, right? So he will be deciding the quantum of compensation. He said that minimum there will be 20 lakh rupees of compensation. Other losses will also be taken into account, right? So what you are able to observe from this article? I have combined three articles actually. This is not one article. Enna purinjuka mudiyudhu? Negligence. That is the only word. Negligence is the only word. Right? That is the title of the article also. Right? Gross negligence. Next one. Scheduled caste instead of Dalit. Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment, they sent a circular to Information Broadcasting Ministry saying that in all official communications from now, let us use the word scheduled caste instead of Dalit. So what? In the fundamental right? Dalit na untouchability. Okay. Let us see what they are trying to say. Your point is understood. If I say Dalit, that means we are alienating from them. Right to equality is not ensured. I am not treating them equal on par with others. Even in official communications, if I use the word Dalit, I am separating them. I am able to understand. But there is large amount of political and social significance present hidden in that word Dalit. Just a mere replacement of word at one particular point of time, there's a chance of people forgetting what all happened previously for that particular section. Right? So there are two dimensions. There are two dimensions which we will discuss. So Information Broadcasting Ministry, they sent a notification to media saying that, media, you also in all official communication, don't use the word Dalit. Instead, you use the constitutional word called a scheduled caste. This is not something new. 10 years back, National Commission for Scheduled Caste, a constitutional body, they also said that let us use the word scheduled caste because scheduled caste is a constitutional status given to the community, right? It is not one community, it is a group of castes coming under the scheduled list which are recommended by the President of India. So let us not say Dalit, let us give the constitutional status given to those section of groups, communities. Right? So what is this Dalit? It comes from Hindi, word called as Dalan, which means oppressed or broken. It was largely used for the first time by Mahatma Jyotirao Phule. Right? So he was using this word often. So he used to refer this Dalit as outcast or untouchables. Outcast means they will not come under that any caste category. We have four caste tribes, Vaishnava, Kshatriya, Shudra, you know that, right? So these Dalits will not be a part of the caste category itself. So they are outcasts, right? And also untouchables. So he used to refer Dalit as outcasts and untouchables. So are broken victims of our caste and society. It was Ambedkar, Dr. Ambedkar, he was using this term prominently, and this term gained more popularity through Ambedkar. Britishers, they were naming Dalits as depressed class or scheduled caste, right? In the Scheduled Caste Act of India 1935, I would like to add something about polity here. While doing polity, something called, see, in modern history, a continue pannina, it is polity. the constitutional provisions, you know, which the East Indian Company and the British government, if you extend that, you will be coming up with constitution. In Lakshmikant also, we have a chapter called as historical background, right? So that chapter, when you study, you know, don't do it separately first. After completing the modern history, you start preparing the historical background. That historical background is very significant for understanding the national movement as well as to understand the polity. So what generally people will do, they take up the book, they start memorizing each provision, what happened in 1773 Regulation Act, what happened in Pitt's India Act, what happened in 1813, what happened in 1833, what happened in 1856. So till 1856, whatever act was passed was by East Indian Company. So in these acts, the British government in UK, they were trying to expand their control over East Indian Company. A small differentiation I would like to say here. Till the revolt of 1857, East Indian Company were looking into the affairs of British provinces in India. From 1773 Regulation Act, the East Indian Company, they were trying to expand their control over the East Indian Company gradually. After the revolt of 1857, British government, it directly took the responsibility of governing India. It sent East Indian Company out. So from 1858, Act of Better Government, from that 1858, whatever acts in 1848, then most significant becomes 1909 Minto Morley reforms, then comes 1919 Montagu Chelmsford reforms, then comes Government of India Act 1935, then comes 1947. All these are very important. So the acts which came after 1857, those are acts where Britishers are expanding the powers of Indians. The governance structures were limited, or it was restricted only in the hands of Britishers. Gradually, they were expanding the powers of Indians. They were including Indians into the governance structure. All right. So this differentiation, you have to keep it in mind. And every act is a result of an advancement in national movement. Don't say national movement resulted only in independence. 1947 is not the only result of national movement. Whatever we achieved in 1909, that is connected with the performance of the, what we call, moderates. 1919, that is because of the contribution made by not just extremists, there are several home rule movement will come by 1916. There are several developments happened between 1909 to 1916. Lucknow Pact, you all know. That developments you have to keep it in mind. 1919-1935. So what are the developments by Gandhi, how Simon Commission reflected, roundtable conferences, etc. So all these are connected with the developments in national movement. You have to connect both these things, right? Sorry, I slightly deviated, because this 1935 is very significant. Large amount of constitutional provisions are borrowed from 1935. It is not that we have to copy, we got used with their governance pattern. So we rectified the problems in 1935 and we imbibed large amount of 1935 parts. In polity, 1935, 1947, 1909, 1919 are very important. They are asking too many questions from that area, right? Summa taniya eduthu vechu padikadinga. You cannot memorize. Study with the developments happened in history. Harijan. So Mahatma Gandhi started referring Dalits as Harijan, saying that children of God. But it was not welcomed by the Dalits or large sections of the society. Last year, Supreme Court said that the word Harijan is abusive. It is giving a patronizing feeling. Someone calling someone as Harijan, right? It appears as if some dominant person is trying to call the lower caste as Harijan. So they also refuse to use the word Harijan. Some new interpretation. So 1970s, the followers of Dalit Panther movement. So again, a movement working towards social discrimination. They were saying that they are giving a different interpretation. Dalit means it is not caste or low caste or poor. It means the deplorable state or condition of a large group of people, right? Because they have been reduced. They are large sections of people. They have been forced to worst situation, a deplorable state, because of the social convention. A large section reduced to this position because of social convention. That is the meaning of Dalit, which Dalit Panther movement is trying to say. Response: some sections are welcoming this, some sections are opposing this. So people who are welcoming, they are saying that Dalit, not just Dalit, even the term scheduled caste, that itself is alienating, that itself is keeping them separate. It constantly reminds the deprivation and humiliation which they were facing. If we want to properly integrate them with the other section of society, we should not use the term Dalit or even scheduled caste, SC, right? That comes with some social stigma. Other sections are saying that, no, see, this has large amount of political and cultural significance. Yes, to ensure social justice, these sort of reminders through this name is very important. This is another opinion. Dalits and also Dalits are beyond scheduled caste. Don't think Dalits means only scheduled caste. Dalit is a very big connotation. Scheduled caste, see, it is a list of caste that can be amended. You can bring new caste into scheduled caste. If you, president feels, if they want one particular dominant caste to be brought under scheduled caste, if president feels, it will not happen. Theoretically, it is possible. Right? But Dalit is something different. Scheduled caste is a list of communities which are referred by president who were deprived of several social rights for a very long period, for which we need to give some empowerment. So that is different, or Dalit is a bigger connotation. So we cannot replace Dalit with scheduled caste, is the other opinion. And another problem, Information and Broadcasting Ministry have sent a circular to media that in all official communication, don't use the word Dalit. What kind of official communication media is going to be involved in? Their context will be always out of context. So how this is going to make a change, that we have no idea. Next topic, public credit registry. To identify a person, whether a good borrower or a bad borrower, as of now, what the banks are trying to do? I go and apply for a loan. Credit score. So that CIBIL score or any credit score given by any other financial services agency, that is the only way as of now to identify a person's credit worthiness. But do you think that alone is sufficient to identify whether that person is worthy enough to get loan? We do not know. We cannot say no, we do not know. The problem is, see, let's take a situation. I am not paying my EB bill regularly. I am not paying my internet bill regularly. I am not paying my telephone bill regularly. I am not paying my rent regularly. But I am paying my bank EMIs. If you just look at my banking transaction, I am good. Right? In that case, by just seeing my banking transaction, I can say that I am having some sufficient credit worthiness. But when I look into other financial transactions which I am involved in, where it is showing that I am not a credit worthy person. Similarly, let us take a company. The company is not just borrowing from banks. It is borrowing from banks. If it wants, it goes to debt bond market. If it wants money, it goes to share market. If it wants money, it even goes for external commercial borrowing. It borrows from foreign institutions, or it can even borrow from some non-banking financial institution. But the credit score given to company is purely based on their banking transactions. I may be good in banking transaction, but bad in, let's say, while paying dividends to my bondholders, I am not prompt. Right? In repayment of my debt to external commercial borrowing, right? I am not prompt. So I am not able to have a holistic information about a borrower. So that can be resulting in NPA. Are you getting my point? So, public credit registry, if you take abroad, this PCR are set up in many countries. They take into account of every information. Individual, all my transactions they will take into consideration. Am I paying my monthly bills promptly? Am I paying my rent promptly? Am I paying my tax promptly, etc. Every transaction they will be taking into account. Holistically, while applying for loan, holistically they will assess my performance. After that, they will be extending loan. Similarly, the case for companies also.
whatever kind of transaction they are involved in, everything will be taken into account. After that, a score will be given. Based on that, the banker can take informed decision while extending loan amount. Are you clear? That is the significance of this public credit registry. So last year, a committee was appointed, YM Diothale committee. So that committee had recommended RBI to set up PCR in India. It suggested the registry should capture all loan information and borrowers should also be allowed to access their history. Let us say I am the person, my information will be in the PCR. Banks, on a need to know basis, it is not open to banks. If banks, you know, on request basis, they can get access to my history. And also, if I want, I should also be allowed to see my past instances, right? So data privacy should also be protected. That will be at stake, right? Significance. As I said, the credit information is scattered. It is scattered. Just through banking transaction, we cannot come to a conclusion. It has to be collated at a single register. That is called as PCR. So in order to flag early warnings on asset quality, this will be highly useful. I mentioned something about special mention account while doing NPA. Nyabarka. What is SMA? When a loan is not repaid for 90 days, that becomes NPA. Before 90 days, if a banker, he senses that this particular person can become a defaulter, this particular loan may become an NPA. If he senses before, there are various clues. Let us say I am involved in some a stock broking company. There's a crash in the stock market. There's a large amount of chances of him becoming defaulter. So banker will know in advance. There are some clues that this person may become a defaulter. This loan may become an NPA. So in that case, that loan, that account will be converted into special mention account. So he will come to know about the asset quality better if there is PCR. Yes or no, a banker, let us say, assume that I have borrowed. When I look at my PCR, I am not paying my rents, I am not paying my other obligations. So PCR will send a notification to banker. The banker can immediately classify the quality of the asset. He can take some early intervention in recovery of loans. In that way, PCR will be helpful. So recently, RBI Deputy Governor Viral Acharya, he also called for amending the RBI Act 1934 to bring PCR into India. And he is also suggesting that PCR should be linked with the GSTN. What is GSTN? Goods and Services Tax Network. So it is a website. If earlier, if I want to file the GST tax returns, earlier I have to return the VAT, I have to return the sales tax. Earlier, I have to go to the tax office. Right? Then I have to fill the challan, etc. I have to do the payment. Now it is very easy. We have a Goods and Service Tax Network. We have an exclusive website for filing the returns. Now I can file e-returns. Right? You will be given a user ID like how you log in into Facebook. You can log in into GSTN website. And you can do the fund transfer either through RTGS, NEFT, internet banking, or whatever methods which are present. Are you clear? So they are saying that connect GSTN with PCR. RBI Deputy Governor says, he also pitches an idea, we will connect GSTN with PCR. What all could be the advantage if I connect PCR and GSTN? If I connect PCR and GSTN, the banker will also come to know about the business of that particular person. See, if tax officials want to know about the performance of Officer AS Academy, they need not come and check the books of Officer AS Academy. That is secondary step. Primarily, by looking at the amount of tax e-filings which Officer AS Academy is doing as compared to previous years. Let's say previous year, assume they have paid 1 crore of GST. Now, let's say, assume they are paying 2 crores of GST. Of course, that's performed. There is a growth of 100% in the Officer AS Academy. Are you getting my point? So, if the bankers are also, monthly returns they are filing. So, monthly business capacity can be understood.
So bankers, if they are getting access to GST and also through PCR, then assessment will become more easier. So we can give loan for actual creditworthy people, and we can also refuse giving loan to other people who are not having sufficient worthiness. That is the significance of PCR. This PCR you can take and you can incorporate while writing NPA answers. You want to give some way forward, right? We can take this PCR.
Sir?
Yes. Nice point. புரியுதுங்களா? When my salary is also linked, my income capacity is also linked with PCR, what is the advantage? The bank will know what amount of EMI I can sustain. If I already have, let's say I can sustain up to 10,000 rupees of EMI per month. 5,000 rupees, I'm already paying EMI. Now bank will extend loan in such a way that my EMI is not exceeding 5,000 rupees. Because 10,000 is the maximum amount I can sustain. All right. Next one, banking ombudsman. So it is a grievances redressal forum. If we have any grievances in banking services, we can go and approach this banking ombudsman. He will be having offices in various parts of the country. Right? So RBI will set up this office. So RBI will appoint a senior official as banking ombudsman. Don't think for every bank there will be one banking ombudsman. Illa, for many banks. Banking ombudsman is an office. In different zones, RBI will be setting up different offices. So when I have a complaint against any services given in bank, I can raise the complaint to banking ombudsman. So what are all the banks which are covered under the scheme? All scheduled commercial banks, regional rural banks, and scheduled primary cooperative banks. Normal banks, regional rural banks, and cooperatives. These are coming under this banking ombudsman. In 2018 February, through a notification, RBI said even the deposit receiving NBFCs will come under ombudsman. Are you getting my point? NBFCs, non-banking financial companies. There are different kinds of NBFCs. Chit fund is also an example for NBFC. Stock market is also an example for NBFC. There are several NBFCs, right? I call it as NBFC because they are having functions similar to banking, not completely like banking. They are financial institutions. Their working is somewhat closer to banking, but not completely banking. I call them as non-banking financial companies. There's a concept called as shadow banking. கேள்விப்பட்டிருக்கீங்களா? Shadow banking. That means they work like banks. They work like banks. So shadow is going to be like you, right? They are going to work like banks, but they will not ensure all the services provided by banking. In India, whenever a shadow bank emerges, immediately RBI will convert that into NBFC. Are you getting my point? புரியுதுங்களா? Shadow bank concept புரியுதுங்களா? Bank-like structure. I will give an example. It was in news sometime back. Have you heard about peer-to-peer lending? What is it, peer-to-peer lending? Mithra intermediaries. Let's say peer-to-peer lending offline is common. I want to borrow something from her. She gives to me. It's a peer-to-peer lending. In online, it is gaining momentum. There is a website called as LenderBox. You can also go and try LenderBox. So where you can register yourself as lender or borrower, there will be a forum where you can chat. The lender and borrower can chat. So borrower, I demand 10,000 rupees of money. Whoever interested, they will come. We will both will be having a negotiation. We will strike out the interest rate and money can be borrowed. The intermediary is going to be the lender box. The money will be flowing via that lender box. Are you getting a point? This was gaining momentum. So this borrowing and lending is one service which bank is also doing, right? This is similar to one of the banking service, right? This is a shadow banking. What immediately RBI did? It studied about peer-to-peer lending. Now recently, it brought peer-to-peer lending under NBFC category. In India, banking norms are very prudent. The RBI will be very strong in regulating all these banking activity. So immediately it brought under NBFC, and there will be regulations for those peer-to-peer lending. It will not be beyond regulations. It will not be beyond regulations. Are you getting my point? And the NBFCs are of different types. Some NBFCs will be regulated by RBI. Some NBFCs will be regulated by SEBI. And some NBFCs are regulated by Ministry of Corporate Affairs. Some NBFCs are regulated by state government. If you take chit funds, are regulated by state governments. Are you getting my point? So don't say all NBFCs are regulated by RBI. Some NBFCs are regulated by RBI. So RBI says that the deposit taking NBFCs will be having this ombudsman. That is the 2018 February notification. So for what kind of issues I can go for ombudsman? Any banking service issue. I am in check clearance, there is a delay. I want to open an account, there is a delay. I am asking for some change, they are not giving, etc. Any kind of issue, you can go to ombudsman. So when I can file a complaint, first I have to go to the bank. I have to file a complaint to bank. If bank is not giving any response for more than 1 month, if bank is rejecting your complaint, or you are not convinced with the reply of the complaint, then after that you can go to banking ombudsman. Right? How I can file a complaint? Write in a white paper or send an email. Ombudsman is not going to charge any money for your service, but he can order compensation up to 1 lakh rupees for the issue which you have faced. So why in news? Now RBI is introducing a new institution called as internal ombudsman. That RBI says that every bank which are having more than 10 bank outlets, they have to set up an internal ombudsman. That internal ombudsman should not be a banking official, or he should not be an official of that bank. He should be an outsider. He will be appointed for a period of 3 to 5 years, and he can be removed only after the approval of RBI. Are you getting my point? So RBI is saying that now if you want to complain, if you want to file a complaint, go to banks first, no response, then go to internal ombudsman next. If you are not convinced, then you come to banking ombudsman. Are you getting my point? This is why it was recently in news. So internal ombudsman to review the customer complaints that are either partly or fully rejected by banks, to ensure that the complaints of the customers are addressed at the level of bank itself. Tenure 3 to 5 years. It can be removed only with the prior approval from RBI. You should be from outside. All these are potential prelims questions. All these statements. Clear? Solid waste management. Supreme Court recently banned the construction activity in Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, Uttarakhand, along with Chandigarh, Union Territory. So why they banned? Supreme Court says that in 2016, central government came with solid waste management rules, and state governments were asked to frame rules based on these rules. These three state governments and the one Union Territory, Chandigarh, they haven't framed any rules so far. Because of their negligence, right? Supreme Court has stopped all the construction activity, and also it slashed a 3 lakh rupee fine on these three states and one UT for not framing any rules. Right? Now we will see what is this solid waste management rules 2016. This came after 16 years of municipal waste management rules. Earlier, we were having municipal waste management rules 2000. After 16 years, we came with solid waste management rules. As the name itself says, that was only with respect to municipal area. Here I am going beyond municipal areas. So before, we will also discuss about what are the provisions given in the rules. Before going into the actual rules, I have given some data, it will be useful. So India annually, it generates 62 million tons of waste, right? Out of which 5.6 million tons is plastic waste, 0.17 is biomedical waste, 7.9 is hazardous waste, 15 lakh ton is e-waste, and remember only 75% to 80% of municipal waste are getting collected, in which only up to 28% are being processed and treated. Clear? See, I will be coming up with some extra points which you may not find in Pulse. I will try to bring Pulse, reflects Hindu, it reflects RSTV, All India Radio, Yojana, Kurukshetra. That is a compilation of these sources. Right? Where also we will be giving some background information. From now onwards, let's say in coming classes, so what I have planned to do is, I'll be giving some extra points to make the topic more holistic. Sometimes I'll restrict only with that article. Sometimes I'll also bring my notes. I'm doing this for some time, right? I have some current affairs material, right? I'll bring it to make it more holistic. So that topic after the class, it will be having more prelims content. It will also have more mains content. Are you getting my point? In certain areas, I'll be including more. Don't say it is not present in Pulse. And also sometimes in test, I used to get some mails saying that you have said this particular statement is correct, but that particular statement was not there in Pulse. Pulse la thappa irukku solala. The statement was not present in Pulse. So how can you say this is correct? I know that was not present in Pulse. I want to educate you. That is why we are providing extra information in test. Wherever possible, we are trying to bring with some extra information. Okay, fine. So as I said, the new rules are applicable beyond municipal area. What are the features? The features is now the waste generators, they have to separate the waste into biodegradable, dry waste, plastic, paper, metal, wood, and domestic hazardous waste. Napkin, diapers, mosquito repellents, cleaning agents, acids, Lysol, etc. Those bottles we have to separate it before handling it to the collector. Rag pickers. Who are called as rag pickers? People who are involved in picking up some useful products from the garbages and they should sell, right? So the management rule says that the rag pickers should be integrated with the waste dealers with the help of state government, initiative of state government, as well as self-help group. These waste collect dealers and rag pickers, they have to be brought under a formal system. The generator, the waste generator, has to pay some fine, spot fine, when he is going to throw, or if he is going to not segregation, or if he is going to throw it in some place where it is not intended to, littering, non-segregation. If a waste collector sees at you, spot fine can be slashed. Manufacturers of diapers, sanitary napkins, they have to provide pouches to keep the used products. So these gated communities, big associations, okay, hotels, restaurants, size of more than 5,000 square meter, they have to have a biodegradable waste treatment plant. Those waste, they have to treat on their own. See, we saw, right, bio toilets. The waste will be brought to a biodigester where you will find anaerobic bacteria, and they will act on that, they will convert that into methane, carbon dioxide, and water. So they are treating there itself. So the areas, gated community, which are bigger than 5,000 square meters, they have to have a biodegradable waste treatment plant. Right? Developers of special economic zones, industrial estates, they have to earmark 5% of their area for waste recycling. Right? Recycling of waste is one thing. I think I have also mentioned about something called a circular economy. Solirkana. Recycling. Paper, used paper, I recycle, I make it into fresh paper. Okay, let us say this bottle, I'm recycling it and I'm making it into fresh water bottle. This is recycling. The old product will be recycled, it will be made into new, same new product. If it is circular economy, the waste of one product can be used as a raw material for creating some other products. Are you getting my point? So that is circular economy. From recycling of waste, we have to move towards circular economy. Dell, I don't think you might be remembering this, they were accepting waste e-products. They went for circular economy. Right? They were accepting the products. They were also paying you, from which they were trying to come up with some new products. Right? So, and also all manufacturers of disposable products like tin, glass, plastics, they have to provide financial assistance to local authorities, municipalities, for establishing waste management system. Clear? So these are regarding solid waste management. So I hope you would have seen your mains question paper. Pathingla, 18 mains. Shall we spend 5 minutes on it? Okay. Were you able to answer some questions using current affairs? So essay pathingla, alternative technologies for a climate change resilient India. See, with 3 months of exposure to current affairs, you are able to generate some points. When you go to your mains, almost 1.5 years of current affairs you'll be having. You'll be in a position to supply very good points. Along with conventional sink, you can easily manage. This question we can answer. Alternative technology. Today also we'll be discussing about biofuels. We'll discuss about electric vehicles. I have in slides. So that you can take it. A good life is one inspired by love, adala venda, guided by knowledge. I mean, that's nothing, that's an affairs, but no current affairs. Okay. Poverty anywhere is threat to prosperity. Okay. Management of Indian border disputes, that is internal security. Customary morality cannot be a guide to modern life. Solunga, solunga. Customary morality is nothing but culture. Cannot be a guide to modern life. The law is opposing it. Culture versus law. That is the essay. Okay. Or religion versus new norm. Modernity and social change. Sociology topic. Abdiyum solalam. Okay. Then nothing much. Then many topics are more philosophical, like ethics. Okay. Then paper one, pathingla. So paper one, society pakla. Caste system is assuming new identities and associational form. Hence, caste system cannot be eradicated in India. Discuss whether formation of new states in recent times is beneficial or not for the economy of India. இதெல்லாம் நீங்கள் சொசைட்டின்னு சொல்லிடவே முடியாது. அண்ட் யூ கேன் நாட் ஈவன் சே இட் அஸ் ஜியோகிரஃபி ஆல்சோ. வித்தவுட் கரண்ட் யூ கேன் நாட் சப்ளை பாயிண்ட்ஸ். ரைட். ப்ளூ ரெவல்யூஷன், டிஃபைனிங் ப்ளூ ரெவல்யூஷன். வி டிஸ்கஸ்ட் அபவுட் ஓஷன் எக்கானமி. திஸ் ப்ளூ ரெவல்யூஷன் இஸ் ஆல்சோ கால்ட் அஸ் நீல் கிராந்தி மிஷன். ஐ வாஸ் எக்ஸ்பெக்டிங் திஸ் கொஸ்டின் லாஸ்ட் இயர் இன் எக்கனாமிக்ஸ். நீல் கிராந்தி மிஷன். ரைட். Mention, that is okay, women empowerment. Globalization is generally said to be promote cultural homogenization, but due to this, cultural specificities appears to be strengthened in Indian society. Communalism arises either due to power struggle or relative deprivation. These are very common society questions. Nothing so new in that. Paper one was relatively easy. Geography questions were very less. There are only 2 questions which are core geography in nature. Right, GS paper 2. In the light of recent controversy regarding the use of EVM, electronic voting machine, what are the challenges? VVPAT. Write about VVPAT and other issues. the National Commission for Scheduled Caste, Financial Emergency, those with just with Lakshmi Gandhi can answer. Health for all, there was a question. E-governance is not only about utilization of the power of new technology, but also much about critical importance of the use value of information. India's relation with Israel, of late acquired depth and diversity, cannot be rolled back. Why there is a question on Israel? Today we will, you will come to know why Modi visited. Centenary year of Battle of Haifa. 2018 is the centenary year of Battle of Haifa. I have in the slides. We'll discuss what is that Battle of Haifa. And 25 years of our diplomatic relationship. Last 25 years we were going closer to Israel. Right? That is why there was a question. So we can get clues from here. That is what I would like to convey. Issue between Lieutenant Governor and Aircut Government. Pondicherry, Delhi, right? That is happening. That is why it was in question paper also. Okay, there is a question on constitutional validity and competency of tribunals. A question on tribunals. Tribunals is directly mentioned in syllabus. What are the tribunals you know through current affairs? You know about the very well, you can write about the competency of NCLT and DRT to some extent, how it plays a crucial role in resolving the cases regarding non-performing assets. Right? Of course, Green Tribunal. We are asking about competency. Right? Which not just requires only current affairs. Concepts also very important. They are asking to compare the India and USA. Second paper is also very easy. Trade war. What are the key areas of reform the WTO has to survive in the present context of trade war? Keeping in mind the interest of India. US-Iran nuclear pact controversy. How it affects the national interest? JCOPA. We have discussed about that. Okay. Two IR questions. Then GS paper 3, first question, sustainable developmental goals. Though we have not emphasized more on that, as I said, it will be taken in environmental class, but I have mentioned about SDG several times. Then another one is about long-term capital gains tax. That was an issue in the last budget. There's something called as capital gains tax. You invest 10 lakh rupees. You are purchasing a land for 10 lakh rupees and you are selling it for 1 crore rupees. Then the gain made in the investment is 90 lakh rupees, on which you have to pay tax. That is called as capital gains tax. There are two kinds of capital gains tax. One is long term and short term. Similarly, you invest in share market, you also make some gain, where which you have to pay some tax. This involves about dividend distribution taxes. It was in news. There was an issue with respect to imposition of capital gains taxes on dividend distribution. That is why it was in news. Next question, what do you mean by MSP? How will MSP rescue the farmers from low income trap? Edithalama?
Yes.
So current affairs we have discussed. Examine the role of supermarkets in the supply chain management of fruits, vegetables and food items. How do they eliminate, supermarket cannot be brought under ENAM. How do they eliminate the number of intermediaries? It is slightly critical. We can bring mega food park. We can mention about the integrated cold chains. You can take ITC as an example. You can also, there is something called as e-chopal. Solirukana? E-chopal. So ITC, what they did, they started creating some internet-based infrastructure in town areas. Let us say, I am a diploma graduate, I know to handle computer. In town areas or in rural areas, an institution, small institution will be created where you'll have IT infrastructure, I'll be managing it. So farmers, they can come to that place, they can trade, they can, you know, trade with the ITC directly. Like I go to Mandi and I can sell. I can go to this eChapel centers. I can go there. I can interact with the ITC officials. I can say that this is the quality of wheat I am having. How much you want? They say I want 1,000 kgs. Then they say, what is the price negotiation will happen? Through this eChapel also they can sell. A kind of enam. But Anna, it is connecting Indian markets, which will be sending their products only to ITC. Okay. Discuss the work of, okay, Bose, Einstein, and other science. See, solid waste. What are the impediments in disposing the huge quantities of solid waste which are continuously being generated? How do we remove safely the toxic waste? Right. What is wetland? We'll wait for environmental class. Sikkim is the first organic state. Current affairs. China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, One Belt, One Road Initiative. IR question they asked in economics. And other areas. See, how has the emphasis on certain crops brought about changes in cropping pattern? I have connected MSP and cropping pattern. We took the example of Karnataka, Maharashtra, how the cropping pattern resulted in water scarcity. So they are, I'm going to change pandranga question. Elaborate the emphasis on millet production and consumption, alternative cereals. Why is there so much of activity in the field of biotechnology? How has the activity benefited the field of biopharma? Nanotechnology, its application in medicine. எவ்வளவோ பார்த்துருக்கோம். தட் இஸ் நத்திங் பட் பயோடெக்னாலஜி. வி டிஸ்கஸ் அபவுட் கிறிஸ்பர், வி டிஸ்கஸ் அபவுட் திஸ் மேக்ரோஃபேஜஸ் இஷ்யூ, ஃபோமிசெல்ஸ் இஷ்யூ, எவ்வளவோ டெவலப்மெண்ட்ஸ் வி டிஸ்கஸ், ரைட்? ஆல் ஆர் பயோடெக்னாலஜி இன் ஹெல்த் சயின்சஸ் இன் பயோஃபார்மா. எக்ஸாம்பிள்ஸ் ஆஃப் பயோஃபார்மா, ரைட்? எம்பிடி 363 ப்ரோட்டீன் ஞாபகம் இருக்குங்களா? ஆல் தோஸ் டைரக்ட் க்வெஸ்சன். With growing needs, should India keep on expanding its nuclear energy program? Discuss the facts and fears. Sir will take care. Okay. Data security has assumed significant importance in the digitized world due to rising cyber crimes. The Justice B.M. Sri Krishna Committee report addresses the issue related to data security. In your view, what are the strengths and weaknesses of the report? Paathom liya? Critical data, etc. He is trying to set up data protection authority. There will be 4 offices, right? India's proximity to 2 world's biggest illicit opium growing states. Golden Crescent, Golden Triangle. Okay. So explain the linkages between drug trafficking and other illicit activities such as money laundering, human trafficking, etc. Right? Measures to take and prevent the same. Anti-trafficking authority bill. Right? One measure I am trying to connect. Ethics, you are looking at. So are you able to understand the significance of current affairs, not just in prelims, also for mains? Even if you take, I have not read the conceptual questions. If you even take the conceptual questions, you will find a link in current affairs. Let us say, Lieutenant Governor and the UT government issues. Why are the question getting? What triggered the UPS to ask those questions? Because that's an ongoing issue. So when we carefully see, you will get the clues for mains conceptual questions as well as prelims conceptual questions, I would say. Are you clear? So by the month of March or April, I will give the compilation of pulse, keeping prelims in mind. I will divide the pulse into economy, polity, social issues, schemes, reports came in news. We will segregate it. You can also do it on your own, no problem. So from which you can have prelims oriented current affairs approach, as well as you will also get clue which polity area which you have to study, which geography area which you have to give more emphasis, etc. Are you getting my point? We'll come back to our class. Price control in pharma industry. This topic may be new to you. Price control. See, Health Ministry, it prepares a list of drugs which are most essential. right? Those list of drugs will be taken by Department of Pharmaceuticals, which comes under Ministry of Fertilizers and Chemicals. This Department of Pharmaceuticals, it will bring that list of medicines under Drug Price Control Orders, DPCO, right? There's something called as NPPA, National Pharmaceutical Pricing Authority. For those list of medicals, this NPPA will be deciding the price. They will fix the price. And they will revise the price by taking into account of wholesale price index inflation into account. They take WPA into account and they will revise the price. For all other drugs, the NPPA says that you can revise the price by 10% annually. Are you getting my point? List of essential drugs, NPPA will decide based on WPA. Others, they can, the pharma companies can revise annually by 10%. Other functions of NPPA: to deal with all legal matters regarding pricing, to monitor the availability and shortage of drugs, and also to look at the market condition of pharma industry, their market share, right, their business potential, profitability, and also bulk drugs and formulations. Bulk drugs means don't think drugs in more quantity. Adana. But there is also another explanation for that. If you take any drug, the drug is made up of two components. One is API, active pharmaceutical ingredient and passive pharmaceutical ingredient. These are the two components of drugs. Any tablet, any tonic which you take, there are two components, API and PPI. This active pharmaceutical ingredient is the actual formula or actual chemical which helps in curing of a particular disease or infection. This PPI, let us take a tonic, the liquid part may be PPA, or the flavors given may be PPA. Actual medicine is API. If you take tablets, the binding force for the tablet is given by PPI. Are you getting my point? When I say bulk drug, that means only API. That doesn't mean wholesome drug, right? Around 20% of medicines are subject to price control. In 2017, an order was passed. Accordingly, let us take this active pharmaceutical, this particular drug is coming under price cap. Assume this particular drug comes under price cap. Let us take paracetamol. I do not know, I am saying paracetamol. This paracetamol has API as well as PPI. I am taking the API present in paracetamol. I am also adding other API, other chemical, and I combine these two and I come with a new dosage or new drug called as, let us say, citrizine. The citrizine API is similar to the API of paracetamol, but citrizine API is more than the API of paracetamol, but still citrizine API is having paracetamol API. Paracetamol is coming under price cap. Now citrizine will also come under price cap. Since citrizine API is also having the API of paracetamol, right? That is the recent order. So this, the indicates that the combination drugs which use price controlled ingredients will now be subjected to price caps. So what are the concerns? The pharma industry are saying that, see, because of so many price caps regulations, we are not able to spend more on R&D. If you take multinational corporations with respect to pharma industry, other countries they are spending 20%, we are spending very less. This will hamper the value chain. This will hamper the process of coming up with medicines for new diseases, right? So government has imposed price controls on 74 notified bulk drugs. 74 notified APAs, Okay, so pharma companies have opted out of production in India. Not just products, this API also keeps some price control on some medical devices. There's something called a stent. Have you heard about stent? S-T-E-N-T. So people who are having heart issues, when they have blocks, using stent you can remove the blocks. Okay, so stent is having large range of applications. Many stent productions have stopped in India, right? And new stent varieties are not being produced in India also. There's some problems with respect to price regulations. See, because of price regulations of API in India, we started importing large amount of API from China. Remember, India is a pharma hub. In pharma is a focus product and China is a focus market. And now from focus market, we are purchasing the focus product. That is not fair. So last year, what happened? It was in news. Last year, since there was an increase in API purchase from China, government imposed safeguard duty on API from China. What is safeguard duty? When there's a sudden surge in imports, to prevent the domestic suppliers, government will impose safeguard duty for a shorter period. So safeguard duty was imposed for API products which were purchased from China, right? So as I said, medical implants, 2/3 are coming from China. Now we are importing, we are trying to import from China. And medical implants, they are also finding issue with these kind of price caps, right? So investors, they are looking for a predictable policy. They want a predictable policy, but what we are doing frequently, we are revising the price of the essential commodities and also we are changing the price of the medical devices. In 2017, we came with a new policy, right? That is not giving some sort of predictability. The ease of doing business for pharmaceutical companies in India is becoming low. And also where you need price cap, in countries where the medicines are costlier, where you need price cap. But India is a place, relatively when compared to other countries, the prices are very cheap. So why India needs price cap? And also there is no monopoly of pharmaceutical companies in India, or there is no oligopoly neither. Monopoly only one, oligopoly 3 or 4. Right? India is having approximately 15,000 pharmaceutical companies. In that case, how monopoly is possible? The profit share of top 3 pharmaceutical companies is less than 20%. So it is highly distributed. Cartelization is also not there. So in that case, why are you putting so much of pressure? Right? So one size fits all price control mechanism can disincentive new innovations in pharma industry. What are the alternative routes? See, we are keeping this price cap because we have to reduce the medical cost. We have to reduce the out-of-pocket expenditure. To reduce the medical cost, this is the only way. Is there any other way? This article is also discussing about that. Yes, there is some other way. Per capita availability of doctors should be increased. Number of medical seats has to be increased. Right? So the government hospitals are overcrowded, underfunded. The staffing competency, competition, competitive spirit among them is also very low. The health expenditure is very low in India. Only we are spending 1.4% of GDP in health. But after the introduction of this health insurance policy, Ayushman Bharat, we will be compelled to spend around 2.5% of GDP, which we saw in class. Central government that's one of the challenges we discussed. Central government has to spend 2.5% of GDP. Currently, we are spending only 1.4. 1.1 we have to increase. State governments, they are spending around 8% of GDP. And they have to increase their budget by 8% for accommodating Ayushman Bharat, which we discussed in class. We discussed, yes. So 1.4 as of now is very low when compared to China. China, they are spending 3%. Brazil, they are spending 4.3%. Sorry, we have to improve our health expenditure. And another solution they are saying is let government directly procure from pharma companies and let government distribute it through government outlets. We have something called as Jan Ashwadi outlets, where we will find large amount generic medicines, generic medical shop. Okay. So we through that outlets, that let it be a part of supply chain, the pharma companies will be selling it to government. So it cannot hike the price to the government. And the pharma company are having direct relationship with the doctors, and the pharma agents, there is large amount of price hike. Let government procure, from government let it go to market. That is another solution. Next one, global mobility summit. First global summit, mobility summit was held in India, organized by Niti Aayog. So what is the aim of this summit? The aim is to revolutionize the public transport, especially the public transport. Revolutionize transport, especially public transport. Right? So what is the intention of India? Make the public transport more affordable, accessible, and also inclusive. Last mile connectivity of public transport is very important. Right? Affordability, accessibility, inclusivity. Nobody should be left behind. Safe, energy efficient, and low emission systems. These are the objective of India with respect to future mobility, future transport. So five important themes were deliberated in this summit, which was held in New Delhi. One is maximizing asset utilization and services, comprehensive electrification and alternative fuels, reinventing public transport, good transport and logistics. Also bring all this artificial intelligence in improving the quality of transport. So many countries, representatives, they participated. What are the highlights? So PM unveiled a mobility roadmap which seeks to increase the investments and manufacturing electric vehicles, increase use of public transport for travel. He also stated vision for future of mobility. He is stressing about 7 C's, like how he stressed secure in SEO. Here he is stressing 7 C's: common, connected, convenient, congestion-free, charged, clean, and cutting-edge technology is required for our to revolutionize the transport system. He is also submitting a report prepared by Niti Aayog, Transforming India's Mobility, a Perspective, where the report says that in the last 44 years, our number of vehicles have been increased by 40-fold times. Right? So why? Because of the absence of proper public transport system. Because of the congestion, traffic in 4 big metro cities in India, we are losing $22 billion annually. You know the relationship between traffic and economy, which we have discussed in Sagarmala, which we have discussed in GST. A truck in India can travel only 350 kilometers per day, but truck in America can travel more than 850 kilometers per day. Large amount of traffic in tolls, state borders, etc. So these congestions are also resulting in large amount of wastage of energy, pollution, health issue, health complication. Again, the out-of-pocket expenditure is going to increase. It is not business friendly. I'm losing many business opportunities. Are you clear? Just imagine, to deliver pizza, it takes 3 hours. No one will order. When there is less congestion, there will be more economic activity in logistics business. The Swiggy is thriving, Uber Eats is thriving, home delivery is thriving because of relatively less congestion. More the congestion, you will lose out that opportunity. So there is a large amount of business involved in transport. Okay. So the report recommended safe, adequate, holistic infrastructure. That is called as SAHI. Safe, adequate, holistic infrastructure called as SAHI. Move Hack was an event conducted in this summit. Okay, here it's a global hackathon. Globally, almost 335,000 registrations were there. They came forward to give solutions for ongoing mobility problems. One UPSC year, they asked a question on particular hackathon. I'm not able to recollect the hackathon question. Smart hackathon, huh? There was a question, not on civil services, but they asked in CAPF exam. Right, this hackathon is about what? Okay. So global hackathon is about bringing solutions to mobility problems. Next one, boosting eco-friendly transport. You know, India largest, one of the largest purchaser of oil, 80% of oil needs we are importing. Every year we are spending 8 lakh crores for purchasing oil. So we have an aim. So what is the aim? We want to make our oil import zero. So government is focusing more on ethanol-methanol blending. Government cabinet also approved a national policy on biofuels. That policy says that now the farmers can sell their surplus food stock for producing ethanol or methanol. As of now, only sugarcane is used for preparing molasses from which we are going for ethanol blending. This policy is saying that, the national policy on biofuel says that we have to come up with that policy is providing opportunities for farmers for selling the surplus stock for manufacturing ethanol and methanol. What happened? Right? So from the doubling of farmers' income perspective, you can also involve this point. Double the farmers' income, this is also one important way, right? So the policy has expanded the scope of raw materials that can be used for producing ethanol. So now including sugarcane, we can use sugar beet, corn, etc., damaged fruits like grains like wheat, broken rice, etc., etc. Currently, ethanol is coming only from molasses. Now we can use all these products also. But globally, there is a debate that how can we use food for fuel? Of course, it is going to fetch large amount of income. Then large amount of food is being transferred to preparation of fuel. Then there will be a large scarcity for food products that might create even inflationary situation. So what can we do? So we will limit this situation. Only whenever there is bumper production, then the surplus should be transferred to manufacturing of fuel. By putting that limitations, this can be prevented. Official target, we have to blend 5% of ethanol with petrol diesel. Currently, government is allowing up to 5% of blending, but we are achieving only 2 or 3% of blending as of now. By 2022, we have a target of blending 10%, right? And also these are relatively clean. These are not emitting large amount of gases, pollution, smoke. So we have our climate targets. This will be very helpful. Now methanol production. This methanol is having advantage over ethanol. Ethanol, the raw material sources are limited. Methanol, it can be produced from coal or biomass, any biomass. Just bring all your organic waste, biodegradable garbages, right? You can convert that into gas. We can convert that into methanol. So any biomass, including municipal solid waste. So a large quantity of municipal solid waste is an opportunity for us for producing methanol. Right, when you write any answer regarding solid waste management question also, where you can also mention about this point. So National Electric Mobility Mission Plan 2020. In 2013, it was launched. What is the aim? To achieve fuel security. To achieve national fuel security, this mobility plan was unveiled. By 2020, we want to achieve a fuel security by promoting hybrid and electric vehicles. So by 2020, we are aiming to sell around 7 million electric vehicles annually, right? Whether it is possible, we do not know, but there is a plan of selling around 70 lakh electric vehicle or hybrid vehicle annually, which can run on both. Hybrid can run on both, okay? So government launched FAME India for the faster adoption and manufacturing of electric vehicles. Faster adoption and manufacturing of electric vehicles. Government came with FAME India in 2015-16 budget. Accordingly, some cash incentive or financial assistance will be given for people who are involving themselves in manufacturing electric bikes and electric cars. Right? So through moving with electric vehicles and electric cars, we can save up to 4 lakh crore. That is the estimate. So government is giving assistance up to 29,000 rupees for bikes and rupees 1.38 lakh for cars. Focus area, technology development, demand creation, pilot projects and charging infrastructure. Okay, so one update information which came in October 17. This will be useful for writing about FAME answers. A medical journal, it is telling that every year around 6.5 million premature deaths are happening globally because of air pollution. In India, 1.1 million. Right? Environmental Performance Index. India got 177th rank. Yabarka. We saw, right? So 177th rank. So where they stated that it is because of premature death caused by air pollution. This is also stating the same point. We can also bring the Environmental Performance Index while writing answer. So in 2014, WHO stated that among top 10 polluted cities, there are 4 Indian cities. Among top 20 polluted cities, there are 10 Indian cities. Right? Our Indian cities are highly polluted. Right? So what is the main reason? Because of the emissions from the motor vehicles. Clear? Have you heard about Kyoto Protocol? Nagoya Protocol. Okay. Just make a note of Nagoya Protocol and Kyoto Protocol. Just make a mention in environmental class, that will be helping you. Note panikonga. Briefly, I will say what is Kyoto Protocol. Kyoto is a place in Japan. Okay, I think in 1985 or 89, somewhere this protocol was signed. Accordingly, what this protocol says? We have to boost reducing emissions. Pollution is increasing, we have to reduce the emission. For which they are coming up with this Kyoto Protocol, they are coming up with some interesting idea. They are saying something called as carbon credit. You can also mention carbon credit. Another the carbon credit. Let us say I am now emitting. Let us say a factory is now emitting a large amount of. A factory is now emitting a large amount of carbon. Ashok Leyland. I will take the live example. Ashok Leyland. Then what they did? They went for changing their energy sources. They went for solar, they went for LED lighting, they reduced their carbon emission. Right? The amount of carbon emission reduced, that will be quantified. For that amount, some credit will be given to you. That is called as carbon credit. Let us say, earlier I was emitting 100 units of carbon. Now because of some change, I am emitting only 50 units of carbon. For the units reduced, you will be getting something called as carbon credit. And that carbon credit can be traded. For example, there is one institution, they are not able to reduce their emission. This Kyoto Protocol was putting some condition on countries in their emission. In turn, there was some condition industries in emission. Let us assume there is one company or industry, they are not able to limit. If they want to limit, they have to go for an overall change, currently not possible. And their needs are more, their emission is expanding. Another side, we have Ashok Leyland, they have made a change and they have reduced their emission, for which they got carbon credit. And this credit can be tradable. Now this industry company who is not able to limit, who wants to increase the emission, no other choice. Now they can purchase the carbon credit which Ashok Leyland is having, and that credit can be shown. Are you able to get my point? By purchasing that credit, 50 units they have reduced, right? 50 units they can emit. For this purchase, this person will give money to this person. This is called as carbon credit. So this monetary incentive will motivate large amount of industries to reduce their carbon emission. Are you getting my point? Are you able to get my point? So it can be traded country-wise also. Delhi Metro, first public authority or public institution, which gained large amount of carbon credit. Eppadi? By laying Delhi Metro, large amount of transport through vehicles, cars reduced, large amount of pollutions were reduced. So they were able to cut down the carbon emission by some percentage. So that equivalent credit Delhi Metro was able to gain, and that was traded for thousands of crores. Enga? Tax? Puriyalappa? அதுக்கு மேலே டேக்ஸ் போடலாமா தெரிலப்பா எனக்கு தெரில. ஸோ இப்போ நீங்கள் வென் யூ ஆல்சோ கம் இன் எக்ஸ் கண்ட்ரோல் ஆஃப் தி கன்வென்ஷனல் ஏரியா ஃபார் த சேம் டாபிக் யூ கேன் ஆல்சோ பிரிங் தோஸ் பாயிண்ட்ஸ், யூ கேன் ஆல்சோ பிரிங் தீஸ் பாயிண்ட்ஸ். ஆர் யூ கெட்டிங் மை பாயிண்ட்? ஃபைன். ஸோ வாட் ஆர் தி இஷ்யூஸ்? வாட் ஆர் தி இஷ்யூஸ்? கோஆர்டினேஷன் இஸ் ஒன் பிக் இஷ்யூ. ஸோ தேர் ஆர் டூ மெனி மினிஸ்ட்ரீஸ் இன் இண்டியா which are involved in transportation, okay? Many departments, let us say civil aviation is with fuel, road transport, shipping transport with fuel, railways also with fuel. Many institutions are there. It is not easy to bring coordination among all the people for achieving this, right? And state governments are also involved in bus transports. They are also should play a key role. Battery issue, all these electric vehicles uses lithium-ion battery. Even in our phones, we have lithium-ion battery. India is not having sufficient lithium resources. We are not producing lithium-ion. We are importing largely from China. But very recently, there was an breakthrough in producing lithium-ion battery in India. So, if we, let us say, by 2020, we have a target of 70 lakh sales of electric vehicles, then 70 lakh vehicles will be having lithium-ion battery made from China. Like how we are depending on fuel, we will be depending on battery from China. Without those batteries, we cannot run our vehicles. So, that is another challenge. So, we have to spend more money on R&D to improve the production of lithium-ion. All right. Charging infrastructure. Currently, China, Japan, European Union, as well as Netherlands, they are involved in electric vehicles, right? But the charging infrastructure, the technology design is not same in every country. Either we have to choose properly to meet our demands, or we have to come up with our own technology. It should be convenient for the users, or else we will not go ahead. Right, economic impact. Currently, this particular sector is contributing 7.1% to GDP. Given the trends, this will give more job opportunities. My business will expand up to $300 billion. 65 million additional jobs can happen. 12% of GDP will be the contribution if this continues by 2026, given the situation I am saying. Now, I want an overall change. From the existing vehicles, I am looking for electric vehicles. So that needs a transition. In this transition, there will come large amount of challenges. There might be an increase in job opportunities for some sections. For some sections, there will be a loss of job opportunities. We need a different skilled forces, right? The opportunity, economic opportunity given by electric vehicles is something different. Whether it can compensate the advantage the current system is trying to give. All these transitions we have to address through a proper mobility plan. Right? Another challenge. We'll discuss about China and Netherlands briefly. China, they are trying to boost the usage of electric vehicles. First, they are starting from themselves. Right, all 2016 alone, 80,000 electric buses were added. Just imagine, all our buses, public transport system are using electric vehicles. Then our attitude will also change. We may also tend to go and purchase electric vehicles. Right, China is trying to boost via buses. Netherlands, it is known for small country, known for charging infrastructure. So they have developed a large amount of technology in charging infrastructure. They are also exporting the technology of charging infrastructure. So how they were able to develop? They gave large amount of incentives for the manufacturing industries who are involved in these productions. Right? So we should also tap the potential of the market as early as possible, or at least to meet our demands. Right? So why in news? There's something called as permit. Any vehicle, I have to get a permit. For what purpose I'm going to use, permit will be given by the government. Now, government says that for electric vehicles, there will be no permit. நியூஸ் ஆர்டிக்கல் சின்னது தான், பட் சரௌண்டிங் இன்ஃபர்மேஷன் இஸ் வெரி இம்பார்ட்டன்ட். தட் இஸ் வை ஐ எம் கிவிங் பேக்ரவுண்ட். ஆர் யூ கிளியர்? லாஜிஸ்டிக்ஸ் அக்ரிமெண்ட். இன் லாஸ்ட் கிளாஸ் லாஸ்ட் டு லாஸ்ட் கிளாஸ் ஐ வாஸ் டிஸ்கசிங் அபவுட் தி இந்தியா டிஃபென்ஸ் ரிலேஷன்ஸ். வேற ஐ வாஸ் சேயிங் தட் 2016 இந்தியா அண்ட் யூஎஸ் தே சைன்ட் அ லாஜிஸ்டிக்ஸ் அக்ரிமெண்ட். சொன்னேன்னா வேர் போத் இந்தியன் ஃபோர்ஸஸ் கேன் யூஸ் அமெரிக்கன் பேசஸ், அமெரிக்கன் ஃபோர்ஸஸ் கேன் யூஸ் இந்தியன் பேசஸ் ஃபார் ரீஃபில்லிங் தி ஃபியூல் ஃபார் சம் அதர் பர்பஸ் ஆல்சோ. லைக் தட் வி ஆர் ஆல்சோ கோயிங் டு சைன். ஸோ ரஷ்யன் பிரைம் மினிஸ்டர் ஹவ் கம் டு இந்தியா, ரைட்? ஸோ வி ஆர் கோயிங் டு ஸ்ட்ரைக் அ டீல். We are trying to sign a logistics agreement between Russia and India. And also we are going to sign an agreement for purchasing different S-400. Okay, almost 4,000 crores worth aircraft we are going to purchase. But America is opposing now. America is opposing. They are saying, no, if you purchase, we are going to face some problems. Let us see what we are going to see. See, remember, after signing LEMOA, Logistics Exchange Memorandum of Understanding Agreement between India and US in 16, we started signing with France, Oman, Philippines, Singapore, Indonesia. Now, we are going to do with Russia. RCEP, I hope you know about RCEP. Solungappa, paakala. What is RCEP? Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership அக்ரிமெண்ட், RCEP. ஓகே. ஹூ ஆர் தி மெம்பர்ஸ்? ஏஷியான் ப்ளஸ் 16. ஸோ ஏஷியான் 10 மெம்பர்ஸ் ப்ளஸ் இந்தியா, சைனா, ஆஸ்திரேலியா, நியூசிலாண்ட் அண்ட் ஜப்பான் அண்ட் சவுத் கொரியா. ஸோ தீஸ் ஆர் தி மெம்பர்ஸ் ஆஃப் RCEP. வேற வாட் ஆல் யூ நோ அபவுட் RCEP? We are trying to formulate, it was proposed in 12th ASEAN Summit. In 12th ASEAN Summit, it was proposed that we will come up with a 16-member grouping, regional grouping, for promoting, for signing a free trade agreement. But India is not so happy. It's not opposing. India is having some challenges in signing RCEP. Recently, we'll discuss, wait. Recently, the talks are never ending. India's interest, India is trying to place in front of RCEP. RCEP, they are trying to place their interest in front of India. It is not complementing. There is no win-win situation. Now, the RCEP members, the proposed RCEP members, they are forcing the member countries to come RCEP into force within this country, within this year. Right? This year, we have to conclude the RCEP. So, the members, the proposed members, whoever want to go out of this RCEP, they can very well go out. They are hinting India. So now we need to know what are the challenges. Why India is not so happy with RCEP? Why India wants RCEP? If India is not happy, can India walk out of RCEP? Or what prevents India in walking out of RCEP? Recently there was a breakthrough. Our commerce ministry, they had a talk with the RCEP members, and some of our interests were protected. In this situation, can we agree for RCEP immediately? We have an election year now. Is it the right way to conclude it now? These are the issues in front of India and RCEP that was discussed in several articles which I have grouped. Since you have an idea about RCEP, tell me what are all the problems or challenges which India faces in entering RCEP. One by one we can say. China factor, of course. Yes, China is a member of RCEP, so influence of China, that point is taken. Then where? When we sign a free trade agreement, let us take China alone. In 2000s, with China, we were having no deficit. But currently, we are having a deficit of $63 billion. And in down the lane, we want to improve our trade more with China. $63 billion of trade deficit India is facing with China. If there is going to be a free trade agreement, then there will be a more free movement of, what is FTA? And two countries sign FTA, it means between the two countries there will be no trade related tariffs for most of the goods. FTA na or single agreement kadaiyadu. There are many kinds of agreements, we commonly call as FTA. Alright, this FTA in general, when two countries sign, the tariff will be slashed for more number of goods. So in that case, already we are having deficit, we have lost our electronics market, we have lost toy markets to China. This FTA will not be useful for India. Not just that, with respect to New Zealand, New Zealand is very strong in dairy products, right? So India is also having an advantage in dairy products, but New Zealand products are relatively more cheaper and qualitative. When it enters Indian market, we might lose opportunities for the domestic suppliers. So that is again India is fearing. Where an issue?
Already we are having many free trade agreements with Asian countries.
Okay, not just with the Asian countries, we have with Japan, South Korea. We also have with Japan, with South Korea, with the Asian countries, we have FTA. So what? I want another challenge. So now the Purunsha, already Asian 10 members and with Japan, with Korea, South Korea, we are having FTA. That point is rising. But how that is going to be a challenge? I want another challenge. What prevents India entering RCEP? Maybe la venda ungalku. Okay, dumping of goods. Okay, China can do, possibly can do. Sorry, I will go into the topic, we'll discuss, because there are some concepts. Okay, it's very important. So you know about Act East policy, connect Act East policy along with RCEP. Okay, so we are trying to Act East with respect to India or neighbors, extended neighbors. Extended neighbors. So for which we use ASEAN, East Asia Summit. What is this East Asia Summit? In 2005, we came with East Asia Summit. Who are the members? ASEAN plus 8. ASEAN plus 6 is RCEP. Add US and Russia. That becomes members of East Asia. Then BIMSTEC, Mekong Ganga Corporation, Indian Ocean Rim Association, we are using these institutions for forwarding our Act East policies. So RCEP, we will directly go into the problem. Japan is insisting on the inclusion of investor state dispute settlement, ISDS. Japan is saying this ISDS has to be taken into account while finalizing this RCEP agreements. So what is this investor state dispute settlement? Once FTA is signed, it will be more easier for other countries to invest in other countries. Japan is also going to flood with investments. Already JICA, Japan Industrial Banks, they are coming and investing large amount of money in our bullet train projects, etc., etc. Here, this particular investor state dispute settlement mechanism is talking about whenever investor comes and puts his money, he is putting his money by looking into the current policy framework. Today I put money seeing GST. Tomorrow GST is being withdrawn. There can be a change in policy. In the example of withdrawal, spectrum is allocated on first come first serve basis. Contract is signed, cancelled, and now it is allocated for some other person who has won the contract through auctioning, cancellation of agreements. All these are disturbing the ease of doing business. It is going against the investor's interest. In that case, if a country signs this particular setup, this settlement mechanism, then the country can be sued. It can be brought to the international courts. Are you getting my point? If something goes against the interest of the investor. So Japan is insisting that this particular mechanism should be involved in RCEP. And another aspect is regarding compulsory licensing. What is this compulsory licensing? See, you know about patents. Generally,
generally a company, a pharma company, will apply patents for 20 years. There are certain products, even after getting a patent of 20 years, Indian government, for certain products, if it feels that product is so crucial for saving the lives of Indians, if it feels it is very costlier, if it wants to make it more affordable, in that case, 4 years after the patent period, 20 years is the actual period, 4 years from the patent period started, okay? After this 4 years, the government of India can go for compulsory licensing. It can make that drug generic. The patent is for 20 years. But after 4 years, it can violate the patent rights. India can give compulsory licensing. It can make it generic. So many will start producing. India went for it. Once it went for it. A cancer life-saving drug that is around 1 lakh rupees. It was sold in market for more than 1 lakh rupees. India went for compulsory licensing. Now it is sold for 8,000 rupees. And not able to recollect the drug name. Are you clear? So what happened? There is a provision for this compulsory licensing in WTO and also Indian Acts. In WTO, we have something called as TRIPS agreement. Trade-related intellectual property rights agreements. Okay. In science class, Sarah will be explaining about intellectual property, patents, etc. Okay. In this TRIPS agreement, we have something called as compulsory licensing. There's a provision for compulsory licensing which WTO allows. Similarly, India, Section 84 of Indian Patents Act 1970, compulsory licensing can be granted after the expiry of 3 years. I'm sorry, I said 4 years. It is 3 years. Okay. So the RCEP members, they are not okay with this compulsory licensing. And also they are not okay with something called as evergreening of patents. I said about evergreening of patents when I was explaining evergreening of loans. Yes or no? So generally, this drugs, as I said, drugs, they are having API and PPI. Let us say for this drug, I have a 20 years of patents. After 20 years, the company, pharma company, they change the formula of API. I mean, without changing the formula of API, they simply make some change in this PPI and they reintroduce the drug with new patents. Same formula. So API is crucial. PPI is not crucial. But by changing the PPI, I come up with a new patent. So India is not encouraging this. Section 3D of Indian Patents Act blocks the evergreening of patents, which the RCEP members are not okay with. India is very good in services. Right? So India wants a free visa regime. India wants free movement of human resources, which the RCEP members are refusing. So there is no advantage for India. If it enters RCEP, we will lose our trade opportunity in goods. We will not be in a position to leverage the advantage of service opportunity which we are having. Service sector alone is facing a large amount of trade, giving large amount of trade surplus to India. A large amount of trade deficit which goods are creating is being offsetted by the trade surplus which services are giving. So we have to make use the advantage of service industry, which RCEP is refusing. Data exclusivity is another problem in RCEP. See, what is data exclusivity? Let us say, while applying, see, I have made a drug. I take it to the Indian regulators. I place the drug along with the formula. The regulators will verify whether this is okay for Indian market. If they feel it is okay, anything, drug or medical device, whatever. If they feel okay, they will be giving you approval. After that, this drug will be coming for market. This drug has got patent for 20 years. Data exclusivity here refers to after 20 years. Now, this formula will not have any patent. Anybody can manufacture. But here exclusivity means this regulator who is having access to the formula for 20 years. Right? After the patent period,
the data should not be leaked by the regulator to any other competitor for another 4 years. In that 4 years, any private person comes with his own formula on giving solution to same problem, which is similar to the patent holder's formula, that is fine. But the regulator should not disclose. Are you getting my point? Because regulator is getting access to that particular formula from the beginning. Here, data exclusivity means 20 years plus another 4 years, the data should not be leaked. After 4 years, nobody comes. The authority can say, competitors come, I am giving you the formula, go and manufacture. That is okay. The RCEP members are saying that the data exclusivity should be increased to 10 years. But currently, it is 4 years in India. Now, they want it to be 10 years. This is another problem in RCEP. Right? So, what will happen if India walks out? You can say it is not favorable. In that case, what will happen? See, China will dominate. US TPP is something similar to RCEP. TPP, US is coming out. US is coming out from various international frameworks. So other groupings will gain more significance where China is dominating. If we come out, we cannot, you know, counter China, or we'll be left out in large decision-making process. Coming out of RCEP is something we are going away from Act East policy. Right? And also it will send a signal that all the RCEP members have sent India out of RCEP. Are you clear? So why it was in news? A recent breakthrough, Commerce Ministry said that a 16 nation, the ASEAN members have, or the RCEP members have accepted to some of the concerns of India. One, they have agreed to relax their visa conditions. Number two, they said with China, with Australia, with New Zealand, there will be a differential FTA for India. For 20 years, we can violate this FTA condition. We can impose tariff on goods coming from China, New Zealand, and Australia. We fear China, New Zealand, Australia. Right? So the RCEP members have agreed, okay, that we, you know, come and participate in RCEP. You can differentially have tariff system for these countries. So both our interests are protected. That is in recent information. Right? But what is the problem? Definitely we will not sign immediately. The talks will go for another year without being conclusive. Because election year, yeah. Because entering into RCEP will create different sort of pressure for the government from the manufacturing industries. Some will be okay with it, some will not be okay with it. So it might take some more time. Injati Srinivas Committee. Okay, this is about RCEP. Idea kadacha oralavukku. The issues with RCEP, why India should go, India should not go. You can able to answer it, right? Right. Prelims, how can they ask? They asked members of RCEP. Or map-based questions you can expect. Clear? Injati Srinivas Committee. Just few more topics, we'll finish it. Enna solirukanga? We discussed Companies Act. To revise the penal provisions in Companies Act, a committee was appointed. We also discussed Companies Law. That committee is nothing but headed by Injati Srinivas, Corporate Affairs Secretary. He is dividing the penal provisions, into 8 categories. He is providing the problems into 8 categories, offenses into 8 categories. For 6 categories, he is branding it as serious offenses, take it to NCLT. For 2 categories, he is saying it is not that serious. We will come up with an in-house mechanism adjudication process. Nothing more than that. From prelims point of view, we should know committee name is Injati Srinivas. Okay. Battle Haifa. So 1918, towards the end of First World War in Israel. Okay, in Israel, our Indian regiments on behalf of British, our cavalry, they were fighting against the Ottoman Turks in Israel, in Haifa city. Okay, this is Haifa. Here, the Ottoman Turks and Indians, we were the face of British. Our cavalry forces, cavalry means what? So, the soldiers at the back of horse, they will be fighting the war. Okay, they were fighting against the people who were holding large amount of guns and other weapons. So First World War heavily proved that cavalry forces makes no more sense. But the Indian soldiers, right, the cavalry soldiers, they won that war, a significant war, without much big loss. We are able to win that war to commemorate that event. Embassy in India, they will be celebrating this Battle of Haiwa ceremony every year. This is the centenary year. Question ketaangala, India Israel, right? September 23rd, the Indian Army celebrates Haifa Day. Teen Murthy Memorial is in New Delhi. After 4 years of that war, Britishers, they constructed Teen Murthy Memorial in New Delhi, right, to mark the bravery of Indian soldiers from three princely states, namely Jodhpur, Hyderabad and Mysore. Right, a small update in Jan Dhan Yojana. So earlier, what was the aim? Banking to all households. Now it has been changed to all adult individuals. Right, OD limit, overdraft limit, earlier it was 5,000, now it has been changed to 10,000. Right, up to 2,000 rupees, no condition for overdraft facility. For everybody who is opening Jan Dhan account, there will be an overdraft facility of 2,000 rupees. More than that, there are some conditions. Eligibility of overdraft, earlier it was 18 to 60 years, now it has been increased to 65 years. Accidental insurance, earlier it was 1 year, now it has been increased to 2 years. Right, we'll stop here. I hope the class was useful. We'll see you next class.